Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? Let's take a lunar journey both with the moon and on the moon. On Monday and Tuesday, the moon is in Taurus. By midweek, it is traveling through the twins of Gemini. By the weekend, it's worked its way to Cancer the Crab, and at the beginning of next week, it lands in Leo the Lion. Now, with clear skies, you can even see how the moon's path this week takes it below the plane of the ecliptic, which is the path along which the sun appears to travel in the sky. So watch the moon again. It is slipping ever lower in its orbit from our perspective, given its inclination of about 5 degrees from the ecliptic. Now this will be most clearly seen on Sunday the 24th, when the moon will be over 5 degrees away from Regulus, which is nearly on the line of the ecliptic. And it is both that inclination and its elliptical orbit that causes libration, which this week brings back into view many of the same craters we looked at last month on the northern edge of the moon. Now, it is usually not helpful to view deep sky objects with the moon nearby, but this week the moon passes by some of the better ones. So with a larger scope, you may still see some detail. On Monday, it is a couple of degrees from the asteroid Vesta, which can still be seen even with binoculars. The following evening, it is literally the opposite side of the star Zeta Tauri from Messier 1, the Crab Nebula, but I guarantee the moon's light will definitely wash out this faint fuzzy. Try for it in a 114mm scope or larger in another 2 or 3 weeks instead. On the 20th, our natural satellite will have settled between the feet of Gemini and positioned about a binocular field from Messier 35, a large open cluster about the same distance across as the full moon. Look to the northern foot of Mu and Eta Geminorum. M35 is a short 2-degree hop from there. And now this week's dark sky fact. The International Dark Sky Association recently announced the US-based home improvement store Lowe's carries dark sky-friendly lighting in its stores. Find their display or look for these fixtures on the shelves. Okay, so that's what to see near the moon, but what about on it? Certainly the northern craters are worth another look this week. But there's a small feature on the moon's northwestern region that is both prominent and challenging at the same time. Within the vast expanse of Oceanus Procellarum is the very bright crater system of Aristarchus, visible even to the naked eye. At only 450 million years of age, this area is double the brightness of the surrounding area, and binoculars make this easier to see. But the real challenging thing is spotting all the intricate detail of this area with a small telescope. Start looking on Friday. On this night, you may see features more clearly as the shadows from the low angle of sunlight create better shadows on the crater and valley in the area. Other small craters and features can be spotted with sufficient magnification and a larger telescope. See the map I'll have at eyesonthesky.com. And now an observing tip. Objects are often best viewed when on the meridian. Try viewing the moon this week when it is near that line for best results while observing the Aristarchus region or the other objects that the moon passes by. Although just past greatest elongation, Mercury is still visible in the first half of the week before it starts dropping back sunward. Later in the week on the 21st, Jupiter appears to pick up an extra Galilean moon as it moves near a 6.8 magnitude star, and Saturn is stationary on the 19th as it begins retrograde after that, as this celestial assist places the planet higher in the sky sooner, more than 10 degrees above the horizon by midnight on the 24th. That's all for this week. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.